diplomacy and history is happening okay. before your eyes, Saeed. I would argue the president doesn't give himself enough credit for what he's done around the world.
What specifically are you talking he doesn't get enough credit for?
Engagement in issues like Iran, what we've done on Ukraine, efforts to dive in and engage around the world. Hamas is not a part of the technocratic government. We certainly expect... Let me finish.
It's not about being right or wrong. It's about continuing to discuss and adjust to the situation on the ground.
The meetings are still being scheduled, but I will, as we have updates, we're happy to provide them.
Jen, some of the wires are already reporting it's happening on Thursday.
So interesting to me to see Democrats who once disparaged, who ignored the violence, I should say, all of a sudden caring about it. But let's not forget what they said previously. Speaker Nancy Pelosi downplaying the violence rocking U.S. cities, ignorantly saying people will do what they do. Jerry Nadler, when asked about Antifa, he said that was a myth that's being spread around Washington, D.C. It's not a myth. In fact, an Antifa individual took the life of an innocent Trump supporter in Portland. You have Rep. Ayanna Pressley saying that she wanted unrest in the streets. Chris Cuomo saying, show me where it says protesters are supposed to be peaceful. I'll give you an idea, Chris. It's the Constitution. Don Lemon saying, quote, the rioting has to stop, Chris, as you know, and I know. It's showing up in the polls. It's showing up in the focus groups. It's the only thing right now that's sticking. So now, all of a sudden, 90 days later, I, from this podium, have talked about law and order. The president has talked about law and order repeatedly. But because the polling has shifted, now it's time for the Democrats to deny what they said previously and all of a sudden focus on law and order. I'll leave you with this. That's like the arsonist blaming the firefighter.
You call for accountability and transparency all the time from any number of governments, and so if no one is held to account, if no one is being held accountable for what happened, it would seem to me that you would have a problem with that.
And if there's more we have to say, Matt, we will make sure you all know.
But I mean, what you have said, that what you said says nothing. I mean, it just it's like saying, well, we support the right of people to breathe. Well, that's great, but if
we have further comments
breathe,
on the case, I will make sure all of you have it.
Okay.
Aren't you a little bit annoyed that the person who was elected by the Egyptian people, Mercy, is languishing in prison while the person who is accused of murdering hundreds of people is actually out on
I appreciate your effort, Saeed. I don't have anything further on this case.
The reason we asked
Saeed, I'm sorry, we're gonna have to move on.
Sure. May I ask you a question?
And wait a minute. No. You can't ask me a question.
Because you can't answer the question.
Oh, you can't ask me a question, honey. I can't answer, so don't even try.
What attracted the father of the Orlando terrorist to your candidate?
He's a mentally ill individual who ran for president.
Oh, that's what attracted him. I get it.
Pardon me?
What attracted him to your candidate? And your answer was he's mentally ill.
Stop smiling and smirking like it's a funny thing.
Very energizing, much like that clip. That does happen to be one of my favorites. I love seeing the liberal snowflakes get triggered. And that happened. That night, actually, my mom said to me, Kaylee, I just want you to smile tonight. Because she was so sick of watching all these people pummel me on CNN and 8 on 1. She's like, I just want you to go on and smile. So that's what I did. And the response I get from the libs is, wipe that smile off your face. And it turned out to be a pretty good clip. And Thug Life has a rendition, I think you guys saw, with the cigar coming down. And great stuff.
Look, I think Joe Biden, what we saw in that debate was that he was rusty and out of practice. And it turns out to run for office and be an effective politician, whatever your political stripes are, you have to engage with people. And he hasn't been doing that a lot. And I think we saw that play out.
So you're not yet at the pull, if this is an emergency, it's time to panic mode.
No, I mean, like anybody who's worked for politicians or elected officials, you know, I was the one who had to go to the spin room after the first Democratic debate in 2012 when Barack Obama had his clock cleaned by Mitt Romney. You know, that night, no one was calling for him to drop out, but it was terrible. His performance was terrible.
Thank you. So one last follow-up and then a separate issue. I just want to be clear. There are congressional leaders who are being briefed on the Russia situation, but the president has still not been briefed on the situation?
Look, this has been asked and answered. The president is briefed on verified intelligence.
And how does he know, if he hasn't been briefed, how is he certain that Russia didn't put out these bounties?
The president is briefed on verified intelligence. And again, I would just point you back to the absolutely irresponsible decision of the New York Times to falsely report that he was briefed on something that he, in fact, was not briefed on. And I really think that it's time for the New York Times to step back and ask themselves why they've been wrong. So wrong, so often. The New York Times falsely claimed Paul Manafort asked for polling data to be passed along to Oleg Deripaska before having to issue a correction. In June of 2017, the New York Times falsely wrote all 17 intel agencies had agreed on Russian interference before having to issue a correction, that it was only four agencies. In 2017, February of that year, New York Times published a story claiming Trump campaign aides had repeated contacts with Russian intelligence, which even James Comey has said was almost entirely wrong, New York Times. New York Times published a column in March of 2019 by a former Times executive editor that asserted the Trump campaign in Russia had an overarching deal that the quid of help in the campaign against Hillary for the quo of a new pro-Russian foreign policy. That's what we call the Russia hoax, which was investigated for 3 years with taxpayer dollars before ultimately getting an exoneration in the Mueller report. It is inexcusable, the failed Russia reporting of the New York Times. And I think it's time that the New York Times and also the Washington Post hand back their Pulitzers.
What pie is it that we are a slice of?
I'm happy to break down the pie for you. It can be peach if you'd like, or apple, or strawberry.
Can you, off the top of your head, identify one tangible achievement that was that resulted from the last QDDR?
I am certain that those who were here at the time, who worked hard on that effort,
one that,
could point out one.
That should not be a surprise question, should it?
No, given Hillary Clinton obvious ambitions that we continually talk about, although she's not giving us much to go off of, it shouldn't have been a surprising question. And having an answer like that, that's one for the Reels for Republicans, yeah, I think, certainly, who are going to be criticizing her.
That's right. But it is, you know, she works for Kerry now, and there is this tension about Kerry versus Clinton, and he wants to be the big man on the State Department's campus. So in some way, she's doing her job. And we all remember Jen Psaki on the campaign trail in 2008, right? You would go to Jen Psaki to figure out, you know.
There's some old Obama-Hillary tensions in that answer, do you?
So that's what, yeah, that's what the idea I'm floating. It's, you know, that's
Hangover 7. It's just carrying that one over.
Hopefully, I'll limit you to 20 questions today. How about that?
Thanks, Kaylee. Will any White House officials be at the rally tomorrow?
There will be several White House officials at the rally tomorrow.
Will those officials, or will you be there, for example?
I will be there.
You and other White House officials be wearing masks at the rally?
It's a personal choice. I won't be wearing a mask. I can't speak for my colleagues.
And why won't you wear a mask? Is it sort of a personal political statement? Is it because the president would be disappointed in you if you don't wear a mask?
It's a personal decision. I'm tested regularly. I feel that it's safe for me not to be wearing a mask, and I'm in compliance with CDC guidelines, which are recommended but not required.
And if I can ask you about last night, the president tweeted out some fake videos, one of which was labeled manipulated media by Twitter. Why is the president sharing fake videos on Twitter about two toddlers? Who are obviously showing a lot of love for one another. It seems as though he's exploiting children to make some sort of crass political point. Why is he sharing fake videos?
He was making a point about CNN specifically. He was making a point that CNN has regularly taken him out of context, that in 2019, CNN misleadingly aired a clip from one viewpoint repeatedly to falsely accuse the Covington boys of being, quote, students in MAGA gear harassing a Native American elder. That's a harassing video, a misleading video about children that had really grave consequences for their future.
So you're saying it's okay to exploit two toddlers hugging one another on a sidewalk to make some sort of political point? As you know, the president has described members of the press as fake news during the course of this administration. When you share fake videos like that, doesn't that make you fake news?
I think the president was making a satirical point that was quite funny if you go and actually watch the video. I think the point is it was a play on CNN repeatedly taking the president out of context. Like the time when you guys had a chyron that read, Trump slammed some illegal immigrants, they're animals. Well, guess what? The people we called animals were MS-13 illegal immigrants who regularly mutilate people in this country. Those things are entirely misleading.
You don't mind pointing out the president has referred to some Mexican immigrants as rapists. He has tried to pass a Muslim ban in this country. He has described black NFL players as sons of bitches if they take a knee during a football game.
That's an absurd attempt to justify the misleading headlines that are regularly on your network. Like, I was just walking in watching CNN as they lauded the quote, rallies in the streets.
Are you saying that the president
got to let me finish, Jim. This isn't a cable news segment. I'm answering your question right now from the White House podium. When I walk out of here, when I walk out here, Jim, and I see on your network celebratory headlines about the rallies and the protests outside, and you actually said protests and rallies. So in light of a protest, if these gatherings happen in light of a protest or a rally, as you say, that rally is to be condoned, but not the president's rally. I mean, it's appalling. You have one person on your network saying that this is a celebration in the streets, a carnival-like atmosphere. There's a guy with a sign that says free hugs. It's beautiful what's happening in the streets. There is music. People are hugging. You celebrate hugging in the context of a protest, but in a Trump rally where we celebrate historic low African-American unemployment, criminal justice reform, HBCUs, that rally is not allowed because guess what, Jim? It doesn't fit the ideological agenda of CNN.
So cordial.
Secretary Kerry this morning.
It's because you're women. No, it's not.